only you were respected better. People laugh at you. People hate you. But why do they hate you? Because they are ignorant. Listen to me. You are not bad. You are good. Oh, this is a nice little film. This is a producer's angel. And I want the internet to know, without any shame, that we love him. Together, you and I are going to make the single greatest contribution to cinema since the creation of 3D! For tonight, on 90s Monster Mash Month, we play Hollywood!
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash. From my laboratory in the castle east to the master bedroom where the vampires feast. The ghouls all came from their humble abode to get a jolt.
When Dracula was a box office hit, kind of, Francis Ford Coppola originally envisioned to do a version of Frankenstein as a companion piece. But for some odd reason, he stepped back and let famed thespian Shakespearean filmmaker Kenneth Branagh take the director's seat. A decision Coppola later regretted after running into too many disputes with Kenneth during filming and his disappointment upon seeing the rough cut to the point the famed Godfather publicly denounced the film. Coppola condemning a movie made by Professor Gilroy Lockhart. Well, that sounds like the sign of a good movie, right? Not so. Anyway, just like with the original novel, we open up on a sea captain that is trying to reach the North Pole, but is having some trouble thanks to a wild storm on the Arctic Ocean.
Iceberg!
Huh. Only 2.5 minutes in, we're already seeing Kenneth's over-dramatic direction. Yes, the ship gets hit with an iceberg and is stuck, but notice the many things that conveniently happen on impact. Some of the crew get injured, parts of the ship are destroyed, and even one person gets tossed off and drowned in the process. Move over, Titanic! There's a new accidental-prone ship in town! That oddly came out centuries before your time. Find themselves stuck in the ice. Literally. They try to get themselves out to the captain's obsession of crossing the Arctic, but come across a strange sight.
Who's your captain?
Yes. Kenneth is not only directing, but also starring as the main character! Part of me finds this to be a bit self-indulgent, but seeing he did the same approach to some of the Shakespeare movies he adapted, I can't complain. However, they discover they are not the only ones out in the storm, as a wailing moan and brief kill of the dogs, which makes the Huskies and John Carpenter's The Thing look like they went down with dignity, are basic signs that give off the hint that something dangerous is out there, and only Victor here has the answers.
Listen to me. I have spent 6 years planning this, my entire fortune. I will not be stopped by you or some phantom.
Huh.
Do you share my madness?
There is a passage to the North Pole, and I will find it.
The cost of your own life, the lives of your crew.
At least it's not as crazy as trying to create a time machine at the cost of selling your mansion, stealing plutonium from Libyan terrorists, and putting your trust in the Republican from Family Ties to help you out. But if you plan this whole trip to the Arctic for 6 years just to see Santa Claus, then it would make you look like an idiot. Just like in the novel it's based on, the entire story is told through flashback, as we see Victor had a nice lifestyle, a nice mother, and an adopted sibling. And just like the novel, the older he gets, the more invested he is in life's mysteries.
You were so hungry for knowledge. Such a serious little boy. But you know, Victor, life shouldn't be all study. There's such fun to be had.
Well, look on the bright side. At least they're trying to make him more sympathetic so we can care about him more when his mother dies through childbirth. I'm not kidding! The order of how the next sequences go is something like this. They dance for a bit, the mother feels like she's about to birth another kid, and then it shifts to her deciding to give her life in order to save the baby. Shame, seeing how in the novel, she died of scarlet fever. That, and it gives them a reason to try and find a way to cheat death. Well, the death of Littlefoot's mother can motivate a trek leading to a great green valley. Why not? Besides, the death of a mother can... Wait a minute. The death of a mother... Really? We're doing this cliche again? Look, I understand they are trying to revamp the whole story as in Coppola's Dracula, but the original reason was fine enough. Victor was already fascinated with life's mysteries and wanted to seek science and nature combined to reanimate life. That's a good enough reason alone. Here, this element was so obviously added to give him more character depth. But it only comes off to me as something you'd find in a Disney movie. But oh boy, that's not all they throw at us. Because the relationship between Victor and his adopted sister, now played by Helen Bonham Carter, gets... interesting, shall we say.
Our dear brothers and sisters say goodbye.
Perhaps they never have to.
I won't if you won't. Are you my sister?
Sister. Friend.
Lover.
Okay! I know in the original novel, the character of Elizabeth was an adopted cousin. Or at least I think she was adopted. And they did this bit where he married her, but... Come on, Frankie! She's your adopted sister! I know you told to take care of her, and you... probably love her deeply, but there's a fine line between brotherhood and incest!
No!
I don't care if she was an orphan and adopted, it still counts as incest! And the worst part is that throughout, we get scenes where she tries to comfort and talk to him. And we're supposed to feel calm, I guess, seeing she is the only good thing to look up to in life. But considering they're going with this incestuous tone, it just leaves me feel creeped every time they make googly eyes and kiss. Ugh. Either way, Victor goes off to university, but unfortunately he finds himself frowned upon by the professors for his beliefs in certain alchemists and his own scientific theories.
Albertus Magnus, his nonsense was exploded 500 years ago.
Cornelius Agrippa.
A sorcerer. An occultist. What is your name?
Victor Frankenstein, sir. Of Geneva.
Oh ho. Another Swiss.
I don't want to sound too nitpicky. But in the original novel, Victor was a student that excelled in chemistry and other aspects of science. An important element that shows how he was able to construct the monster and bring him to life. Seeing him here being tossed about and accused like a kid that believes in fairy tales just feels kind of low. Maybe it's because I'm not resourceful on these types of past standards, but sometimes It just seems off here how they see Victor as an outcast because of this.
Mr. Frankenstein of Geneva, I warn you, what you are suggesting is not only illegal, it is immoral.
Rubbish!
But as luck may have it, he does manage to make some friends with another student and Professor Waddleman, played by John Cleese, who reveals to him that he too has the same interest in reanimating dead tissue, considering he had experience before in what I have to admit is a cool scene with some creepy quality to it.
Feels warm.
It is,
yeah. Turn it off!
God, it's not working!
No, this must work!
You think that's bad? Be lucky I didn't try this out on my Norwegian blue parrot. So Waddleman forbids Victor into playing God because he feels his experiments resulted in them being, as he describes it, abominations. But tragedy strikes as Waddleman gets killed by a patient during a pox vaccination, resulting in Victor breaking down and uses Waddleman's notes to work on his own creation. So let me get this straight. He promised his mother he would find a way to cheat death, and now he's following the footsteps of this no more, cease to be professor to avenge his death as well. Looks like Victor has a lot of reasons into bringing a dead body back to life. Yeah, quick question. Couldn't his motive been more simple and not too complex? Just asking. Thus, Victor goes about and gathers parts for his creation. The bulk of his ingredients, including the body of the person who murdered Waldman, the brain of Waldman, some additional parts, and the amniotic fluids of a pregnant woman?
That's the combination! That's it!
I'll buy that. For now. However, the only thing standing in his way of his experiments is an epidemic of cholera and, oh god no, the sisterly love interest. Yes, apparently Victor was so obsessed in his work that he didn't even bother to write to his sweetheart. Then again, I wonder if he's still attending classes at the university.
I cannot abandon this work now.
Before us? Goodbye.
You know, I will give Helena this. I can tell she's doing a good job playing the love interest here, but what's holding me back is the fact that she's playing an adopted sibling. I know I should shut up about it, seeing how we are getting to the creature. But it just doesn't seem right. I understand that her character has no father or mother, but just because she's adopted doesn't make her suitable for marrying. But enough of that. We have a dead body to bring back to life in a sequence that is cool, but rather over the top nonetheless.
You need to be the moonshot treatment. Get to jumping like a real life wire. You need to be the moonshot treatment.
Huh. Do eels work that way? An electric eel is capable of producing shocks up to 600 volts. Guess with a motif like that, they're going for a more realistic approach, seeing how difficult it would have been to wait for a thunderstorm.
Oh yeah, here comes Cooley, here comes Cooley, I'm gonna save the day.
Well, I guess Victor is proud of his work, seeing he was able to bring the dead back to pardon?
Tomorrow this journal and its secrets must be destroyed. Forever.
Okay, here's where I get split. Not just with this adaptation, but the novel as well. In Mary's original story, and of course, Kenneth's adaptation, once Victor creates this being, well, maybe this will explain it.
It wasn't supposed to be this way. It was supposed to be a thing of beauty, not this abomination.
Yep, old Frankie didn't appreciate his creation, and he turned against it because of its ugliness and grotesque appearance. This is why I like the 1931 James Whale adaptation better. In that one, Victor was aware of how monstrous his creation would be and only cared about the aspect of bringing the dead back to life. It didn't matter if it had stitches and green skin. The purpose of the experiment was achieved. But hey, we need a reason for Frankie to abandon his creation. Problem is, I'm not accepting it. Are all scientists that particular of what an experiment should look like? Sorry, but I feel that abnormal brain plot device is more interesting.
Bring out your dead! Bring out your dead!
I'm not dead!
Bring out your dead!
Now here's where things split into two as we focus on the ventures of the creature in the real world, and Frankenstein trying to get over the grief of his creation. Can you take a big guess of which I care about more? I'd give you a cookie, but I don't have one. But the concept of Victor abandoning his creation, I feel more sorry for the monster, considering how more fleshed out they make him to be. The first public encounter he has is a post-epidemic, and yet they claim he's responsible for it. And that's not just sad, but even hard to watch, seeing it's his first outing. Even Robert De Niro's performance works well, seeing he has to use a lot of body language for the first bulk of his scenes. This is more notable when he hides out in the barn of a family's cottage, and from the way he observes them. You can tell he wants to be a part of their lives and do good. But the true tragedy is that the viewers know this isn't possible. In fact, come to think of it, this movie should have been more about him. Yeah, not the creator, the creation. Because every time we cut back to Victor, it's something about his love life with his sis Elizabeth, or the fact that he's trying to get over his failed experiment. The more we spend with Robert De Niro as the creature, the more I'm actually really connected to him. He's a biological outcast that wants to have a place in society. But what's holding him back is the disfigured appearance. Yeah, because don't judge a book by its cover has been used once too often these days, let alone how much it needs to be hammered into our heads. Even when he gets to talk to the blind grandfather, you can almost hear your heart break up. Not just at the sad nature of the scene, but just how innocent Robert plays the creature out to be.
Have you no friends?
There are some people. But they don't know me.
Why do you not go to them?
I am so very ugly. And they are so very beautiful.
I'll never look at Taxi Driver the same way again.
Yes! And you can write that down in your journal!
Stupid! You're so stupid!
Victor? You just had. Just had! To put that journal in your coat pocket that the creature is conveniently wearing. You do realize that once he finds out that you neglected him for having a hideous look, he will try to hunt you down like a dog for revenge. Idiot. And that's exactly what happens. After being neglected and unloved, the creation decides to raise hell for Frankenstein. Thanks, movie. Now you have me rooting for the monster. I guess I can call this a good thing, seeing how the whole who's the real antagonist here is being played a little ambiguous. No way, it's about as messy as a sloppy Joe on Saturday nights. With custard. And just like in the novel, the creature sets it up so Victor's favorite maid did the dirty deed of killing his little brother. This is pure evil genius planning right here that only a mastermind can come up with. But where it leads into...
Oh boy.
My God, what are they doing?
They must have broken into the jail! Well, for God's sake, man, can't you stop this?
They've gone wild! This is a lynching mob!
At least she was given a fair trial in the novel. Anyway, Creation meets up with Creator and tells him to meet up at the top of a snow-capped mountain in the distance. And he's met with what I have to admit is an overdramatic slow-mo scene in all of overdramatic slow-mo scenes I have ever witnessed.
Hi-ya!
Wow, for a push that soft, it seems rather effective. Maybe too effective. Regardless, it transitions into probably the best scene of the movie, where Victor meets his creation, and they have a very philosophical conversation. Now, despite the fact I care less for Frankenstein, I do like the things this creature has to say.
What of my soul? Do I have one? Do you know I knew how to play this? In which part of me did this knowledge reside? And reading and speaking, not things learned so much as things remembered.
You see? If the movie was more like this, it would have been a unique examination into what humanity fears the most. The unknown. It would have been a really good concept to look into. But it's about as far as things will get for something as Socrate as this. Well, the creature decides he wants something to appreciate, as the world won't appreciate him. In short, he wants a mate. But he goes back on the deal when he finds that the creature wants to use dead matter from his friends, and literally runs back to Elizabeth to reconsider her ordeal of being wed. On the plus side, he gets a life. On the downside, it's with his non-biological adopted sister. Please. Please. Tell me we don't get to see their honeymoon night. Excuse me for a moment.
Yeah.
clean. Cleanse me of my cinematic filth. Clean.
On the outside, I'm calm. But on the inside,
I want to finish this movie already, so let's do so I can wash it off.
I understand. People hate seeing me this over-eccentric. So, I'll try to remain calm as I can be. Let's continue.
So before any of the real action can begin, and thank God for it, Victor claims to hear a noise of the creature outside and runs out to investigate. But little does he know, he's being played for a sucker.
You pretty. Me put something inside you.
And probably the weirdest way to go, aside from getting your heart torn out, Elizabeth's body is knocked off the bed and a good portion of her hair catches on fire. Talk about convenient. But maybe this is the point where Victor should learn to live and let die. He's dove into his work too much, and this is where he suffers for not experiencing the true value of life. So, I give this movie one more chance to redeem itself. Does Victor ever learn from this? Crap. That's right. After all that trouble of making a living being that is hunting him down, Victor actually uses the conveniently set up machinery to bring Elizabeth back from the dead and live a happily resurrected ever after in hopes of making sure no promises are broken and thinking this is the solution of his problem. Where do I begin? First, you're not just committing incest here. You're committing incest in a wrong so unspeakable it can only be said in one word. Necrophilia. Second, have you learned nothing? After all that trouble of making a creature that now despises you because you despise him, do you even think that no good would come from this? Not every problem can be solved with scientific measures. Third, you used the body of your little brother's nanny in order for this to work. In terms of working body parts and piecing them together. No beauty will come from this. Seriously, I wouldn't date that thing in a millisecond. Fourth, unless you had a spare glass, the experiment needed amniotic fluids of a pregnant woman in order for this experiment to work. You even said it yourself. So, unless you had a spare jar of it laying around, there's no way this could possibly work. Fifth, and final of all. You do realize you just fulfilled the wishes of your enemy. You were tricked into resurrecting her so the promise of your monstrous creation can have his mate. Did you even think for once, just for once, that maybe, I don't know, just maybe, you were being suckered into doing this? For someone with an intelligent brain and knows how to bring the dead back to life, never in my entire life have I seen something as moronic as you to be so selfish and not care about the measures of your life and consider the danger that led you into this point. In short, it was a great fight, Ma, but I lost. But give Elizabeth some credit, she's the only one with brains to do something, and even more intelligent than anyone else in this film, upon realizing she is an ugly piece of assembled parts and how two men are after her affection, she lights herself on fire and sets the Frankenstein mansion ablaze. Thus, Victor finally ends his tale before dying, but the captain doesn't believe a single word of that. That is, till he sees the proof taking a sympathetic visit.
Who are you? He never gave me a name.
Oh. Well, That's unfortunate. You know, despite the last few minutes there is of this, and considering how attached I am to Robert's performance as the monster, I think it's appropriate to give what the creature wants. Hence I dub the Captain Shakespeare. So upon seeing Victor wasn't mad after all, they do the best thing for him and performs a basic funeral on the ice. With fire! Considering how much there is left of this movie, I am not even going to rant about that, as the ice starts to break up. But, oh no! Who's gonna light the corpse on fire and cremate Victor? But why, Captain Shakespeare? Why?
I am done with men.
Captain Shakespeare, you were so close to being likable as Scred. You won't be forgotten. Why do the good have to go in bed shut like this? I seriously wanted to give it high marks for making a sympathetic version of the monster that nearly matches Karloff's, but the production and overall execution just feels manic and off-putting throughout. There's too many overdramatic moments to take seriously. Some of the characters feel like they could have been easily cut out of the movie considering their undeveloped nature, and in terms of the look and color scheme, it's dull. Very, very dull. And I never thought I would say this, but it's slightly worse than Coppola's Dracula. Don't get me wrong, I still can't stand that flick, but at least it was watchable to a degree seeing it had Anthony Hopkins and at least a broader use of bright colors, in contrast to how limited Kenneth's Frankenstein was with the choice of grim and darker colors. My theory is that Kenneth wanted to follow in the footsteps of what Coppola did with Dracula and apply the same method of how Dracula was executed. In my opinion, that wasn't a good idea, and you can see why I feel it didn't work. It just feels like it was borrowing too much from Coppola's vampire flick, and boy, does it show. The only good thing I can say is that there's currently a workprint in circulation, containing 10 minutes of cut material, and believe it or not, they slightly improved the movie. Just a bit. It's interesting to see the many cuts made, considering the small trims in dialogue and rearrangements in certain sequences. The more notable bulk of the footage is a scene where Victor tries to reanimate his landlord's dead dog, a bit where the creature kills a prostitute played by Faye Ripley, and additional bits of gore that was cut to get an R rating. There is more to this cut, and it shows that they started with something promising, but the post-production trimmed it down to something less appreciated. However, it doesn't change my entire view of Kenneth's Frankenstein, but the work print at least made some enhancements on certain scenes, such as the questionable aspect of Waldman's work.
We are on the verge of undreamt of discoveries if we only have the courage to ask the right questions. Now you must help me, please.
I have come across men like you before.
Either way you look at it, Kenneth's Frankenstein had promise, and what affected it in the end was how the way it was trying too hard to live up to what Coppola established with his monster. If only there was some way a movie like you were more appreciated. A way to give it a new life. Like a book like you could be any help.
Well, that was anticlimactic. Great. Now I gotta find a better way to end this long-running marathon of 90s horror. At least something in the time frame of the 90s. Something unique. Something absurd. And something monstrous. Nuts to that! We're doing Nightbreed next.
In the velvet darkness of the blackest night, burning bright, there's a guiding star. No matter what,
scene, I'd ask for another million.
Cut.